Hello and welcome to Reasons Why Wycombe High, our welcome webinar to introduce you to the school recently named by the Sunday Times as the Secondary School of the Year 2023. I'm Isabella, currently in Year 7.
And I'm Ashita, and I'm also in Year 7. This show for Year 5 students thinking about coming to Wycombe High and their parents is being brought to you from our state-of-the-art green screen studio at Wycombe High TV, the UK's only student-led school TV channel. And today is your chance to get to know a little bit more about our school and discover just some of the reasons why Wycombe High could be the perfect choice for you.
Coming up, you're welcome. Current Year 7 students reveal their favourite aspects of the Wycombe High school experience.
Hi, I'm Inia.
And I'm Serena.
And today we're going to be asking Wycombe High students
why Year 5s should join our school.
In their element, our head teacher, Mrs. Renyard, visits students in our multi-award winning science faculty.
And thanks for the memories, as Year 12 students look back on their time at Wycombe High.
I think I've developed as a person in Year 7 and 8. The way I made friends was just, my character was completely different to the way it is now. And I learned a lot about myself as well in the process.
All that, plus we have a Q&A session with our head teacher, Mrs. Nicola Renyard, and some of her senior team. If you have a question, please type it now in the Q&A box at the bottom of your screen.
Now, just to let you know, you will be able to come in to take a tour of the school starting in September so that you and your parents can see Wycombe High in action and everything the school has to offer. To book, please visit our website. It's nice and easy to remember. It's wycombehighschool.com. And in the meantime, here's a little taster of the unique Wycombe High School experience.
Remember, there's lots more photos and information about the school on our website, where you can also catch up on all our latest news and enjoy watching more than 1,000 hours of Wycombe High TV video content presented and produced entirely by students here at Wycombe High.
Now, that's what I call a binge watch. Talking of videos, we've got a few to show you tonight to give you the flavour of the Wycombe High School experience. First up, our head teacher, Mrs. Renyard, talked to Year 10 students in our multi-award winning science faculty.
So you're in the middle of an experiment in this lesson today. Tell me a little bit about what you're doing.
So we've been investigating whether specific reactions are endothermic or exothermic, applying our knowledge learnt from previous lessons in this topic.
And sort of tell me, what's the point of learning that? Like, where's it going to lead you into future lessons?
For us, it's really important to see how specific concepts are applied, and practicals are actually a really fun and engaging way to see how that's applied in the real world and in future job careers as well.
Fantastic. And I guess a big part of science is learning the content, isn't it? But you've also got to develop lots of skills, such as the ones when you do the practicals. Talk to me a little bit about some of the skills you develop in your science lessons.
Yeah, it's quite important to learn how to take in instructions and like execute them properly, especially in a team working, making sure everyone has a role and understands what they're doing.
Yeah, I've been watching you all a bit earlier, actually, working in your team. Everyone's sort of divvied up the workload. And I guess also, you know, the accuracy of the recording. And is that...
Yeah, there's a lot of, like, measuring properly because one person will be getting the ingredients put into it and then people will be measuring them using the vials and things to put in.
And some of those skills that you developed, have you found that they're useful across your other subjects too when you end up working in a team with other students?
Yeah, they are, especially in other sciences like chemistry and biology. They also have practicals, so it's quite useful.
And do you think that you're inspired so much by your GCSE that maybe you'll go on to study science further at A-level?
I think Mr. Nadim especially does push all of us to try our hardest. Mm. And it's really encouraging because we can see beyond the curriculum and how the content applies other ways. So, yeah, looking forward to future career maybe in that.
Fantastic. Well, good luck to you both with your GCSE. Thank you for talking to me. There's so many opportunities here to get involved in science outside of the classroom. And I know that you're our chemistry leader in Year 10. Tell me a bit about what you do with that role.
On Tuesdays, there's a chemistry club and we organise different PowerPoints to teach younger children. And it's very like, instead of just chemistry in the classroom, it's outside in the whole world. We've looked at cosmetics and perfumes, and that really, children really enjoy that because it's something that you wouldn't necessarily see in the classroom. Mm.
So you're really making it relevant for them, I guess, because sometimes when you're a younger student coming into secondary school, you don't always see that relevance.
Yeah, I think sometimes when you first come in, it's kind of like, I don't see how this applies to my life. But especially like outside, there are lots of ways that chemistry and other sciences are seen every day.
And you're developing great leadership skills here for the future and maybe to be one of our student leadership team in our sixth form, potentially.
Yes, it's a great opportunity and you can do lots of leadership things during that, yeah.
Well, thank you for your hard work on it. It's much appreciated. I've interrupted your experiment here, but tell me a little bit about what you're in the middle of doing.
So we're currently doing different reactions and seeing whether they're exo or endothermic, because that's what we've been studying at the moment. So we have different experiments going on in there and we're just measuring the change in temperature.
And do you do experiments a lot in lessons? Does it make a big part of your lessons, or is it sort of a few theory lessons, then a practical lesson?
Well, yeah, often we do practical lessons because core practicals will come up in our GCSEs. So it's really good practice and it helps us understand the equipment that we're using as well.
Fantastic. And I suppose you have to really develop skills of working together with each other when you do these practicals. How do you divvy out the workload?
We just kind of all make sure we're chipping in and everyone's doing something and helping if they can.
It's quite a nice chance to work together and must sort of help you in your other subjects a bit too.
Yeah, it's really nice to be able to cooperate with other people when we're in lessons.
And do you guys feel that you might take science beyond GCSE, maybe to A-level or even further than that?
Yeah, I think so, probably.
Yeah?
Yeah, I think definitely chemistry is really good in medicine as well, so yeah.
Yeah, fantastic. Well, all the very best with your GCSE. Good luck with it.
Another unique aspect of the Wycombe High School experience is our huge number of clubs and societies, more than 100 of them, from ukulele club to choir, rugby to chess, ultimate frisbee to Bollywood dancing. There really is something for everyone. Of course, there's this place, Wycombe High TV, the UK's only student-led school TV channel, produced and presented by us, the students.
Serena, quick sound check for me, please.
1, 2, 3.
Yep, I can hear you clearly.
Okay, lights, camera, action.
Morning, everyone.
Morning, everyone. Let's get your mic down.
Brilliant, thank you.
So, it doesn't matter how many takes you take, as long as you have fun and you get it done. That's
okay.
All you need. So I'm going to signal you here. There's going to be a red light. You have to ignore it. And then,
yep. Okay, thank you.
Well, I can tell you that it's now 2 years since we formally launched Wycombe High TV, Britain's only student-led school TV channel. In that time, hundreds of students in all the year groups have enjoyed producing and presenting hundreds of video reports and more than 1,000 hours of content for the school's YouTube channel and social media feeds. Thanks to the generosity of PAFA, the Parent and Friend Association, the student media team produce high quality content using state-of-the-art equipment, including a professional lighting rig, cameras and 2 editing pods. And at the heart of it all, this, our green screen studio, which as regular viewers will know, can take you here, or here,
or even my favourite, here. Well, we could all do with a bit of sun at the minute, couldn't we? From presenting to directing, cameras to sound, and script writing to editing, at any one time, dozens of students are involved in the making of Wycombe High TV.
And to find out more about the Wycombe High School experience, do tune in to Wycombe High TV. The link is on the bottom of your screen. Well, we've given you a taste of our science faculty, so how about an art subject? English, where Mrs. Renyard caught up with some Year 13 students just before their A-level exams.
So this is Year 13, English, been studying it now at A-level for 2 years. Tell me a little bit about what you've been doing.
So we've been doing lots of Shakespeare, which we're doing today. We're looking at Hamlet. But I think my favourite part of the course has definitely been the Gothic. I've really liked doing Dracula, The Bloody Chamber and Frankenstein, and just comparing them and see how they have progressed throughout history, how the Gothic genre has changed is really interesting.
Yeah, it's really quite fascinating, isn't it? And being able to bring in those historical skills to sort of track it over time. And what skills do you have to employ when you're doing your English work?
It's very homeopathic. You have to understand what the entire context of it is. Mm. And it's really interesting because it's more investigatory than you'd think it would be. Mm. Lots of the time it's not like why did an author put this, but what was the context in the time that would have informed what this author was trying to say and how people interpret it as well. It's very interesting.
That's a great sales pitch for the course. What are you studying alongside English? Are your other subjects similar?
Well, I'm doing politics and biology, which is not very similar at all. But
actually, you've got a lovely mixture then, but I bet some of those skills are really transferable.
I'd say maybe not with biology, but I'd say definitely with politics. You have a lot of the context, and it's nice where they when they cross over, which is rare, but it's interesting.
Yeah. Well, fantastic. Well, good luck with your upcoming exams.
Thank you.
Hope they go well. How are you getting on with the Hamlet so far? Are you enjoying studying Hamlet?
Yeah, I really like Hamlet. It's a really good text because I think it links a lot to like ideas in today because it's quite a broad text that explores like a lot of themes like philosophy. So.
Have you had the opportunity to go and see Hamlet at all performed?
Not really. We do like watch a lot of adaptations in class, so that's quite a good thing.
Yeah. So you've seen it a little bit on the screen. I think it's always a bit magical and it comes to life a little bit when you see it performed. And I know that you're an aspiring medic. So how do you feel that your English A-level is going to sort of help and support you with your aspirations in medicine?
I think it will maybe help a bit with the research side because you still have to write essays and stuff. Mm-hmm. And I think being able to think quite creatively and outside of the box will also help with a career in medicine.
Absolutely. I think it'd be a real string to your bow. Well, all the very best with it. Thank Good luck. You. So I think you're studying English at A-level, but also planning to head off to university to read English. Tell me a little bit about that and how much you've enjoyed the subject.
I've enjoyed the subject a lot. Ever since year seven, I've just been really interested in just reading, really analysing. Mm. It was sort of my favourite thing to do, favourite subject. Always looked forward to it. And so that's why I decided to do my UCAS application and try and do it next year. Which I'm really looking forward to.
And where will you hopefully be studying come September?
Hopefully Cambridge. Yeah.
Wow, fantastic. Yeah. Well, all the very best with that. And in terms of sort of the different types of literature that you've been exposed to, I know that obviously you look at a whole range of different texts. What particularly are you drawn to? Is it the plays? Is it the novels?
I'd say definitely more so the novels. Plays can be very good, but I find it takes a while to get absorbed into them. So I do a lot of independent reading, but especially in coursework, that came in handy because it's reading novels, you know, dissecting them. Mm.
Have you got any book recommendations for all of the viewers of Heads Up this week?
I think just to stay true to coursework, I'd say Revolutionary Road, purely because I studied that. There's many more, but
I'll add that to my reading list. Yeah. Okay, I'll check it out. Well, all the very best with your upcoming exams. Good luck.
And you can watch loads more videos about all aspects of the Wycombe High School experience via wycombehighschool.com and on Wycombe High TV. The link is on the bottom of your screen. Now, when it comes to deciding if Wycombe High School is the right school for you, you might think, who better to ask than some current Year 7 and Year 8 students? So, we did just that.
Hi, I'm Inia.
And I'm Serena.
And today we're going to be asking Wycombe High students
why Year 5s should join our school.
Why do you think Year 5s should join Wycombe High?
I think they should join as there's lots of opportunities and you get great experiences from the school.
Vedanshi, what's your reason for Wycombe High?
My reason for Wycombe High is because it's got lots of sports and a great education system, so I would definitely recommend going here.
What is your reason for Wycombe High?
My reason for Wycombe High is because they have a lot of ways that people can express themselves, including extracurricular clubs.
What advice would you give to Year 5 students?
Well, I'd like to say that there are so many clubs here, there are so many millions of opportunities, and everything is just so much fun, and it's definitely worth anyone's time to come to Wycombe High School and enjoy these multiple activities, extracurricular, sports, languages. There's everything you need here.
Well, those were some great reasons from our Wycombe High students.
Personally, I think they should join Wycombe High because there's a great education system and they're really welcoming.
Don't forget, if you want to book a small group tour of the school starting in September, all the details are on our website, wycombehighschool.com. Well, Isabella, our work is all but done.
Yes, that's it from the two of us. But don't go anywhere just yet, because our head teacher, Mrs. Renyard, and some of her senior team will be right here for your special Q&A session right after this clip, featuring a group of our current Year 12 students looking back at their time at Wycombe High School.
You can watch the whole of the Year 12 conversation via wycombehighschool.com or on Wycombe High TV. The link is on the bottom of your screen.
But for now, here's that sneak peek clip, right after which it's our live Q&A session and your chance to ask your questions about the unique Wycombe High School experience. See you soon.
Bye for now.
I'm going to ask you a question, guys. If you could go and do it all again, would you?
I think definitely. I think I've developed as a person in Year 7 and 8. The way I made friends was just, my character was completely different to the way it is now. And I learned a lot about myself as well in the process. Mm.
Yeah, I definitely would. I mean, I've always done something every lunchtime, a different club every day. So I've just had so many new experiences at Wycombe High that I'd happily do again. I mean, the school work can be hard work, but everything else sort of makes up for it.
Yeah, it's definitely worth it.
Yeah, I would say absolutely. There are so many things that you could still get involved in. Like, you can't experience all of the clubs and societies here, but...
No, there's over 100. Yes, good luck going to all of them.
Yeah, and just how it changes you, how the school changes you as a person, how much you develop, that is just the most valuable transformation for your life.
Yeah, definitely.
I think I definitely would, especially with the new clubs that are being implemented this year and next. Then that's something I would get into as well. And I do think it would just enhance my experience.
Yeah, I definitely do it all again. Because, you've got clubs and things like that. You've also got the pastoral help. But also, it's just been a great school. And, like, for example, sometimes you have to stay after school for a little bit longer than you need to. But you can come into school from 8 o'clock in the morning and you can leave as late as 6. I don't think I've ever gone that far, personally. It's a bit late for me. But it's great because you've got the incredible library, you've got all the incredible staff, and I feel like there's always something to do. You can get involved in loads of things. I'm really lucky to be doing the magazine this year. That's been absolutely great. And I've been able to go and see just how much this community has to offer. And there's things in hidden places that you can find in the school community. And the teachers are there to support you. The staff, the entire school community are there to support you and find what you love. It's just brilliant. Yeah. Thank you guys for coming and joining me. It's been great. I've learnt a lot about you. Thank you.
Good afternoon. A very, very warm welcome to all of our parents that we've got logged on online. I hope we've got many Year 5s joining you as well for our welcome webinar. My name is Nicola Renyard. I'm head teacher here at Wycombe High School. I've been here at the school since last September, so my first year. So some of those feelings about sort of choosing your new school, I can share with all of you watching at home. I've sort of recently been in that position, albeit in a slightly different context. I'm joined this afternoon by some of my colleagues who are here with me to help field some of your questions this afternoon. And we hope that we can give you a really good sense of who we are here at Wycombe High School. So I will introduce them to you to start with. One of my colleagues, Miss Alice Drysdale, has joined us this afternoon. She is our assistant head teacher who leads on admissions and also on learning and teaching and various other things across the school as well. So without a doubt, your daughters will see much of her if they join us here in September 24. Mrs. Sarah Ellis is one of our assistant heads and also our head of sixth form. We use our sixth form here at Wycombe High School to do much work feeding down the school. She can answer some of your questions about where your daughters might end up at the end of their 7-year journey with us. And then finally, we also have Mrs. Andrea Paskins, who is our head of year seven. And we have a dedicated head of year seven here at Wycombe High School. And Mrs. Paskins has been at the school quite a number of years now and is an expert at supporting those year sevens through that transition. So between us, we hope to be able to answer any questions that you might have. I want to extend my thanks to Isabella and Ashita, who were your hosts for the very first part of the evening in our opening video, and also to all of our students that were involved in putting that content together. As you can see, Wycombe High TV is a big showcase for us here at the school, and the students are very lucky to have those opportunities in our recording studio. Today is your chance to ask questions ahead of visiting the school. There will be an opportunity to visit in person and to see a school day in operation. We believe that that's the best way for you to see what we do here at Wycombe High. So a date for your diaries is the 3rd of October, when we will have our open day, and there'll be the opportunity to hear a bit more from me as head teacher, to meet some of my colleagues, but also to have that valuable tour around the school and visit some of our lessons. So please do make a note of that date, the 3rd of October, and you can find further details about that on our website. We'll give you another reminder of that a bit later. For this webinar, though, if you would like to ask any questions, if I could please ask you to use the Q&A function rather than the chat function, which is where we're monitoring all of your questions coming in. And I think we've got some already. So I'll hand over to Ms. Drysdale, who is going to field some of those questions for us this afternoon.
Absolutely. Well, good evening, everybody. It's a pleasure to be speaking to you. And so I've got a lovely question here, which I thought we might start off with, and then we can get into some of the more specifics, which gives everyone a time to do some more typing as well. So what's your favourite part of the school? So I'm going to ask Mrs. Ellis first in a moment, because I've been thinking about that one, and then Mrs. Paskins, then we might go back to Mrs. Reniel with that one. I think I've got a couple. It's really difficult to pick one. I love my classroom and where I'm teaching. That's always a great place to be. I love the learning centre. It's a really buzzy place, our library. It's a beautiful space. It's always very well used. I love borrowing books there myself. I love talking to the girls about what they're reading. And again, one of my favourite places is actually the front gate. So we do our duties there in the morning, and saying good morning to the students as they arrive is a really nice way to start the day. So I think that's what I'd pick. So what, Mrs. Ellis, would you pick?
I think you've picked some of mine, actually. I would say generally it's wherever the students are. You know, I obviously sometimes you can have other jobs to do, but I think, you know, I really come alive and I really enjoy being in the classrooms or the open spaces, you know, being out on break duty and just literally sharing the day with the students and seeing how much they're enjoying what they do every day. You know, it's what we come for work to work for every day. So literally anywhere where the students are.
Right. Mrs. Paskins, where would you pick?
Yes, so I agree with both of you, obviously, wherever the students are, but I love the science labs. I had induction day last week with the new year sixes, well, the new year sevens, the current year sixes. And one of the taster lessons we gave them was the science labs, because students in primary school love, love, love to be in science. They want to see, I think they had flying tea bags, and they were filling up little plastic bags that were growing and growing and growing. And they had such a great time. It was something very exciting. And everyone wanted to use a Bunsen burner as well, which was really exciting to see. One of my other places that I really like is our amphitheatre. The students, when they first join here, that kind of is our year seven area where they go at break and lunchtime. And it's a great place to make friends, meet other students, and we have some friendship tables around. So that area I love as well. We have great outdoor spaces here, actually, as well. And the Learning Centre. Going into the Learning Centre and the wealth of different books we have is another favourite area for me as well.
So Mrs. Reniard, where would you pick?
That's given me plenty of thinking time, hasn't it? I can't disagree with anything that my colleagues have said before me, but I think my favourite thing about the school is the sense of community that we have here. And I was proofreading a bit earlier today, actually, a school magazine which has been entirely produced, written, edited, put together by a group of students, and it captures some of the achievements and their memories from this last academic year. And it absolutely, in a nutshell, is that community spirit that we have. And you're having worked at other schools, you don't always see that. So it's not necessarily a location in the school or sort of explicitly the students, because it's everybody that makes that community. But both of those things sort of really feature into that. So I think that's probably my favourite aspect of the school.
Lovely. So we've had a couple of questions about clubs. The students mentioned them quite a bit, so I thought I might mention some of those. I'm afraid I can't help the person who's having technical issues with their black screen. I hope that's resolving itself. So I've got some questions here about a gymnastics club and a cheerleading club. Yep, we've had both those this year. Cheerleading was on Monday, gymnastics was on Friday. I don't know what days it will be next year, but we have absolutely had both of those. Swimming team, musical lessons. So yes, there's lots of sports teams. We actually have a separate website for all our PE activities because there's so many. So you can go on there and see their results and how they've been doing. And musical lessons, yes, not just piano. There's different instruments that students can take up through individual lessons, but we also have incredibly strong, particularly brass in year seven. All the year seven students take up a brass instrument, and that's absolutely amazing that, you know, by Christmas they're already producing and in concerts, which is absolutely joyous to see. But there's the ukulele group and flute group and concerts and galore and orchestra and all sorts of groups with music. So there's lots and lots of music going on.
And I piggyback on the back of that, Miss Drysdale, because we are very much part of our ethos and our values are very much to sort of give students the opportunity to pursue their passions. And you will have heard the students mention in the video that you watched at the very start of the webinar about the over 100 clubs and societies. They really do range wildly in scope. So we have some of these sort of more conventional type clubs, like ability to have music lessons or take part in the swimming club. But we also have things like Bollywood dance. We have a chess club. We have debating. We have mock trials. The range and the scope is absolutely incredible. So wherever your daughter's passions lie, I feel reasonably confident that she will find something that sort of fits into that genre. And we work very hard to celebrate all of those things too. So we have numerous music concerts that run through the year, sort of focused on either different instruments, different parts of the band. We had a band night, which was incredible fun. But we also have lower school concerts, upper school concerts, so for the different age groups as well. Last week we celebrated our sports women with our annual sports awards evening, which is organised by our PE team. It's where we sort of celebrate participation but also achievement in all of the different sports. We're very excited to have some messages from some sporting celebrities wishing our students well with their sporting endeavours. So we have a real breadth, but we also try to champion and celebrate that breadth, because we really believe that, you know, whatever a student's passions are, they should be allowed to pursue those in an environment where they feel that that is celebrated.
Interrupting, I was just going to say that actually, you know, many of the sixth formers will run those clubs, so we have quite a lot of leadership opportunities throughout the school. So students in year 12 will take on the role of subject captain, and many of those captains will run some of those clubs, you know, not always working, as Mrs. Renyard says, in kind of the traditional way. They'll pick up on certain aspects of their subject that they might want to share and sort of infuse those students lower down the school. So we have a freshers fair in September for all our sixth formers, and they basically will set up which is not just limited to you know, to them just being involved, but it's really about them sharing their expertise and kind of cascading that enthusiasm down through the younger year groups as well.
And yes, so in terms of some specific questions, art clubs, yes, various. And Mrs. Ellis is also an art teacher and will be happy to talk more about those. football, absolutely, there are football clubs and football team. We also have, we do have a swimming pool on site, but I would say it is very non-functional. But the Handycross Hub is literally a sort of 5-10 minute walk away. And so that's a swimming facility. The students can use that for that. And then there was a question, D of E, yes. So our students have recently in year 10 completed their D of E expedition for their bronze award. And students can also do their silver and gold. And that is one of then the goal is access an enrichment opportunity that is part of the sixth form curriculum.
Think there was another question, Miss Drysdale, about are the clubs reasonably priced?
Thank you.
And they're free. You know, our clubs are generally during the lunchtime, so they're accessible to everyone and they're free to everyone. We do have a few after school clubs that people can pay for, but they're an addition to everything else. So the 100 plus clubs that we talk about are during the daytime.
Yes, and normally those ones where there's a charge, it's because there's a specialist coach coming in, like fencing is one I know for that instance.
That leads quite nicely into the question that one parent has asked about the structure of our school day, the timings of our day. So we start here at Wycombe High at 8:40 in the morning and we finish at 3:40. And throughout the day we have 5 1-hour lessons and also a tutor period. So that's approximately 20 minutes that the students spend with their tutor group. And we have a vertical system of tutoring here. So your daughters will be in a tutor group with students from all other year groups, from year 7 through to year 13. So they're taught in their year groups for their lessons, but for tutoring, we have a vertical structure, and there's lots of reasons why we've adopted that structure here, not least because we find that being able to lean on their peers sort of higher up the school is a real source of sort of advice and support for students, particularly as they come in, and also something aspirational as they sort of look to the years ahead when they are the ones supporting the new students that are walking through the door in year 7. We have a reasonably long lunch break, as we've just been talking about the clubs and visits. So we have an hour and 10 minutes at lunchtime, and that's to enable us to run a whole range of extracurricular opportunities during that period of time. And the students still have time to get their lunch. And there are some clubs at the end of the day, but predominantly they run during the lunch break.
So we've had a couple of questions here about supporting students' well-being and how do we help them navigate the pressure of expectations while navigating that interesting time as they grow into adults. So Mrs. Paskins, I thought I might get you to answer those ones.
Yes, so we do a whole wealth of things when our students come to join us. Actually starting from before they come through the door, as soon as your daughter is offered a place at Wycombe High School, we start to plan a visit to see your daughter in her current primary school. And that's to ensure that she sees one of us in her setting where she feels comfortable, she feels happy, and she's got the support of her current teacher. So we will go, we will meet with your daughter, we will explain the process that she's going to have over the next few months before she joins us, and allay any fears, answer any questions, you know, and just make sure she's happy and settled. And it's a very gentle process moving from primary up until secondary. It's, we will see your daughter, then we have your daughter come in with yourself for induction evening. So she's now stepping foot into the school for the first time as a new student, but with her parents. Her parents will then go off to a little talk with us and your daughter will meet her class for the first time. However, it's all about getting to know you, getting to meet the people around you. She'll have a house captain who's giving her some little videos and some getting to know you games, supported by my colleagues in other heads of year. And then the next day she'll come in for her induction day. And that's the first time she's stepping onto our site on her own, but she's already had these tiny little steps leading up to this. So she'll be coming in, having met staff, having met other students, hopefully made a few friends the day before, and is having an exciting day ahead of her. So she's having taster lessons that are going to inspire her, with teachers that are going to inspire her, in grounds that are sort of beautifully kept, hopefully, on a sunny day. This year we managed to make it through before it rained. you know, having food from our forum, sat down talking to other students. So each step that we do before she's even come in is looking at your daughter's well-being, making sure that she's feeling happy and settled. So by the time she comes through our door in September, she knows a lot about the school, she knows a lot about the staff, and she's met many of the students as well. Then once she's into the school, we have things like our well-being tables, our friendship tables. We have a games club specifically for year sevens with older students where they can go if they're not sure where to go and who to meet, and we can buddy students up. We have a lovely hub, which we have our well-being team and our individual needs team. They work in a small area where they have a lavender garden and a nice area for students. So if students want to go to a quiet area or if they want to talk to people. And we're all here to support your student, your daughter. Your daughter has heads of house, heads of year. We have a really good student support team led by two qualified nurses. Other members of the leadership team. There's so many people here to support your daughter. And for us, it's really important that her well-being is looked after and supported, because she will fly. Once she's in this school, she's very able anyway, and she will just take off as long as we do all these other things.
I think one of the things I would say as well is that our students are, you know, they acutely remember those days when they started school. And I think the older students really genuinely do look out for them. You know, obviously we do have sort of buddy systems and so on, but they genuinely are sort of out there. We don't have to ask them to do that. And you can see often many older students picking younger students up and making sure and taking them where they need to go and looking out for them, so that there really is this lovely community atmosphere. And I think, you know, they very much enjoy being able to help and support. So, and I think, you know, the younger ones really appreciate that, and sort of it feeds through into future years and so on as well.
Absolutely. And, you know, in terms of the information they're given, absolutely, they get a map of the school. And we all understand those first few weeks, they're going to take a little bit of time to orientate themselves. And also they don't get homework during that first couple of weeks. And we've got a question about that homework. So it's 2 to 3 subjects a night, 20 to 30 minutes. That's what we would be expecting for them. And that we don't have a list of books we'd be expecting them to read. They're reading, absolutely very important, but there's no particular set texts we'll be asking for in that year seven.
Ms. Drysdale, could I just segue back to the question about sort of wellbeing and pastoral support? My colleagues have very sort of eloquently described the structures that we have in place here, to just explain to parents that it's an area of the school that we have invested in very heavily over the last sort of 3 to 5 years under the previous headship, and it's something that I'm very committed to as well. Parent myself of a daughter and a son in year 7 and 8 respectively, so I've sort of been in your shoes reasonably recently. And I think we would all agree as parents that the things that are at the top of our list are that our children are safe and happy at school, and that's absolutely our number one priority here. But we also want students to succeed in whatever their chosen path is, so we work very hard to give them the tools that they need to manage their mental health and their well-being proactively. That's with the staffing structures that we've got in place, but it's also through our curriculum and the topics that we discuss with them, and the tools and the strategies that we give them. Because what we do find, and we do consider ourselves to be, you know, experts in educating girls, is that a number of our students carry a real weight of responsibility around on their shoulders of achieving and wanting to do well, and they fear failure. And we understand that really acutely here, and we work with them to overcome those feelings where they emerge, so that they can sort of own them and they can respond to them. And I think that's really important for parents to know about our offer here at Wycombe High School. You know, we are concerned with positive outcomes. We want the students to do well insofar as that is what they want. But we also, you know, we want them to do it being happy and being safe, and being able to manage all of those aspects of life and all of those challenges that will be thrown at us, you know, during your school years, but also in the years beyond. So I think that's a very important part of what we offer here at Wycombe High School.
That leads into then a question we've got about what we think the benefits of a school being an all-girls school is, and do we have any links with the boys' schools or other local schools? And Mrs. Ellis, you wanted to address that one. I'm sure the rest of us have thoughts too.
Well, I think, you know, obviously at the end of their 7-year journey, students do go on to university and so on. And I think one of the things that I think one of the benefits of single sex education and what we can offer here is that students really develop that confidence in subject areas they might not ordinarily do so, you know, in a mixed school and so on. We have a number of students who go on to do things like aeronautical engineering, nuclear engineering and so on, who really kind of pick up that mantle and that confidence from being in that environment, whereas as young women, they can really thrive in those classrooms where perhaps if there were boys around in the sort of less traditional subjects, you might expect girls to succeed in. They really fly. We have students who, a large number of students who take maths, further maths, chemistry, biology and so on, and who really aspire to those really top, those top career pathways and so on, and do go on to succeed in them. So I would say certainly that is a real strength that gives our students. You know, we are very lucky because we have a boys' school just across the road. So often they will share buses and so on with those students, but we are developing more and more opportunities to work with the boys' school. Obviously now that COVID has passed us and so on, we're able to interact in a different way. We're looking now at ways in which we can bring that experience and that expertise and that understanding through, certainly through the sixth form, but also how that can then feed into lower down the school and how we can kind of build that confidence to still be a strong, powerful individual, but alongside other boys and other students.
I think it's always asking those questions of a school as well. That, and part of the things, if you're coming into a school which is an all-girls school, if you're asking the question, well, do girls teams and clubs get the same funding and the same priority? That's not a question you have to ask. It are the equal numbers of girls and boys in leadership roles? Again, not a question you have to ask here, because there's always going to be those opportunities for our students, and that's what helps them develop that confidence. Is there's always those opportunities for them to do the leadership roles, the leading a club, the starting a club up, taking those things and really running with them and moving on then into their next stage, ready and willing to be change makers. So we've got some more sort of day-to-day questions. So in terms of times of day and how the day's organized, houses, those sorts of things. So I'll try and deal with some of those sort of bread and butter ones. You might find useful, we have a frequently asked questions document on our admissions part of our website, which quite often answers quite a few of those types of questions. So in terms of subjects, there's lots of subjects the students do. I'm just going to look at my other screens to make sure I don't miss any, because there are a lot that they can do. So in the excuse me folks, they've got multiple links open. In year seven, students will study, and I've got a particular question about the languages here, so if I start with those, they can study French and Spanish and Latin. Then in terms of their other subjects, English, maths, science, religious studies, history, geography, technology, which includes food technology, product design and textiles, art, drama, music, P, personal, social, health and economic education, and in year eight they add on computer science onto those as well. So there's lots of things that they can absolutely choose from, and again those choices just expand a little bit for them at GCSE, and you could find that on the curriculum section of our website. And in terms of how that works then in a day, so students arrive for 8:45 and our first lesson starts at 8:50, and our lessons are an hour long, so there's two lessons, and then they go into tutor time, which, as we said, is vertical tutor groups. Each tutor group does belong to one of our six houses, and so there's lots and lots of tutor groups. And then break time, another two lessons, so our lunch starts at 1:30, and then a final lesson at the end of the day from 2:40 to 3:40. Students can be on site from 8:00 in the morning, and they can also stay in the learning centre until 5 to 6 of the day as well, if that helps out with people's arrangements in their day. And for the students who are joining us in year seven, they will be taught in six groups of 32. There's a completely mixed ability, there's no setting at all in those. And there's a question there about how many students sort of leave during year seven. It hasn't been any this year. It's very, very few, if any. It's normally, you know, relocating to a different part of the country or world is very often a reason for that. So I've hopefully done some of those sort of everyday type of questions. Oh, but school assemblies would happen in tutor time. And again, there can be different ones for those. There might be whole school assemblies with a member of the leadership group. There can be house assemblies, and there could be year group assemblies.
Right. A couple of questions there, Miss Drysdale, about the house system as well, which yes. Mrs. Paskins, as one of our head of houses, is well primed to answer.
Yes, so we have six houses. All our houses are named after inspirational women. And when we chose them a few years ago, the students chose the houses. So we have Austin, Bronte, Curie, Nightingale, Pankhurst and Parks. And I'm head of Parks House, very proudly. We're quite competitive. We're running up to the end of the year and we're looking forward to winning the House Cup. So everyone has been beavering away in our last minute competitions to try and get as many points as they can towards the end. So when your daughter joins us, she will go into one of those houses. It's a bit like Harry Potter's sorting hat. We put all the names into a computer and out they come, and your daughter will be allocated a house. However, if she has a sibling in the school, or if mum came to the school, then she would go into the same house as the other family member. And people love their houses. Our form tutors are within our houses, so I have 10 tutor groups within my house. And even within our own house, we're quite competitive with one another. We raise funds for a chosen charity each year. This year we'll be looking at local charities to support, and our students do a variety of activities to raise funds for those, as well as everything else that we do. But anything to do with house points, sports day, inter-house, competitions, all add up and go into this final, very important cup that we're looking forward to.
Lovely, thank you. Miss Ellis, you've said you'd like to answer, quite correctly, a question about where our students go after sixth form.
Well, they go off to a variety of different opportunities. Obviously, with the pandemic and so on, some of those choices in the last few years have been slightly limited, but we're really pleased that last year we started to show a slight increase again in apprenticeships, which obviously pre-pandemic was starting to build up, and then obviously those opportunities weren't quite as readily available and so on. So the landscape is changing year on year. We have roughly about 90% of students and more that go to university every academic year. Last year we have seen a pickup in students wanting to do a gap year because suddenly they can travel again and so on. But generally we have around about 70% go to a top research university every academic year. Last year we had about 74% of our students got their first choice of university. And I think one of the things I would point out is that actually we don't really set targets of where we want students to go. We listen very much to what students want to do. And, you know, we encourage them to look at the course is absolutely right for them. So while students are very, very able and so on, we don't just focus just on Russell Group universities. There are so many amazing courses out there, particularly with industrial experience, that students will focus on in areas like, architecture and so on, that actually we don't just focus on those Russell Group opportunities, but looking at what is going to be the most suitable course to enable to propel that student to the future that they want to have. So we're very much focused on their choice and so on, and we work with them. I always tell the story that a few years ago we had a student who wanted to do cordon bleu cookery, and very proudly we facilitated and supported them in that option, and I believe now they're working for one a very, very prestigious restaurant in London. And so basically whatever your daughter wants to do, we will support, and we will enable them to find their way to that future aspiration.
Which sort of is a good segue into questions about lunch. So thank you for that. So someone equally motivated as food as I am. So yeah, lots of choices at lunch. There's a main meal the students can have. There's sandwiches, there's salads. There's sort of what we term grab and go items. There's vegetarian options. There's halal options in there. So there's always lots and lots of choice there. So Mrs. Paskins, do you want to answer that question about transport links?
Yes. So Obviously, where we're based, a lot of students come up to our school on a variety of transport, predominantly buses, actually, and our buses come from around a number of areas. So if you're looking from particularly the Taplow, Burnham, Maidenhead area, we have about 10 buses now that come up to us, and they're run by two companies, Apple and Hayfordian. But we have many other buses coming in from the Gerrards Cross area, Great Missenden, down the hill. They come from the Oxford Way. We have people that come in from Reading Way via bus. But we also have people that come in via train. So if you're coming from Uxbridge or further afield, we have students that get the train into Wycombe train station and then get a bus up to our hill. So there are plenty of travel options, and we're based right at the top of the hill off the M40 for easy access to parents also who are driving in. And we have the Handy Cross Hub where parents can drop their children off and they can just walk across the road to us.
Indeed, yes, so the underpasses do make that very much more helpful. So if we're talking travel, Mrs. Ellis, international trips.
Well, again, you know, I keep talking a lot about COVID, but obviously the provision that we were able to offer during those years and so on, you know, was obviously more limited. We are starting to build back that portfolio of opportunities. This year we have managed, you know, with all credit to our staff who've actually kind of shoehorned as many visits in as they've been able to do so, some kind of coming together at sort of, you know, quite short notice and so on. But we are looking at kind of at standardising that process and so on, and really making sure there's a really strong portfolio. So students who are coming in year seven will be able to anticipate that actually in year nine, they'll be able to do X, Y and Z, and year 10, they'll be able to do, you know, the things that they'll be looking at other students doing. So it's something that is developing. We have a mixture of trips. We have daytime trips, we have residential trips, we have evening trips to the theatre. We do have international trips that are linked to curriculum areas, but also the very popular ski trip that we do. And also we do also run World Challenge visits every year as well. So this academic year, we're looking towards Costa Rica, which is going to go out next summer. So there are a wealth of opportunities available for your daughters over the course of their 7-year journey.
So we've got a question here about houses having colours, and yes, they do. And one of the fun things is that whichever house is in the lead on house points that week, flag will be flying in the school grounds. So you can see it from the amphitheatre. And the way students get house points is very much linked to our learner characteristics, which we've mentioned before. So for us, these are really fundamental characteristics of these of our students that we want to develop to when we send them out into the wider world. And we sort of, there's more underneath them, but they get summarised as being creative, brave, resilient, open-minded, reflective, and self-knowledgeable. And so our house points are absolutely tied into those so that students know why they're getting them in terms of developing those characteristics that are going to really make them strong lifelong learners. So we've got a question here about uniform. You will have seen from the video, no ties. So that one we can answer quickly. We've got another question here about students with disabilities, and I think it's worth saying that actually there are students who have disabilities within the school. I mean, Mrs. Paskins, Mrs. Ellis have worked with both of those in their past roles, so if you wanted to speak to that a little bit.
You want to go first, Mrs. Paskins?
Yes, so we have many students with disabilities who can't be seen. We have students, obviously, with visual disabilities as well. And as a school, each and every student is valued and looked out for and looked after by our staff and respected by everyone in the school, no matter what disability you may have. And we have lots of support in the school for everyone. So whether your child has an individual need, whether your child is a wheelchair user or has a hearing impairment, or a visual impairment, we adapt and we work with students to make sure they are given exactly the same experience as any other student. And everyone in the school will help and support them in that way. Our students are so kind, so caring, and so are our staff.
I think the other thing I would say is that, you know, we do have a charity network throughout the school. So actually our heads of house We'll have a house captain who will fundraise for a particular charity. This year, we're trying to make sure that those are local charities so students can actually really seriously engage, not just with fundraising, but with the cause that they're actually working towards. So I think, you know, that it never ceases to amaze me how socially aware our students are. And I particularly notice that more in the sixth form. But, you know, they are. You know, tough cookies. They really do have strong opinions about how the world should be, and how society should act. And you know, they are incredibly empathetic and impassioned about things. So, you know, it's not just about working with those individuals. They really do have a real strong moral compass and so on, and really sort of look out for anybody in society and kind of really work towards making that a part of their everyday life. So it's certainly something that is encompassing everything that they do.
Thank you, folks. We've also got a question here about bullying, and it's a rare event, but we need to be able to manage it when it happens. So, Mrs. Paskins, could you talk to us about that?
Yeah, so we provide a caring and friendly and nurturing and safe and inclusive school for everyone. However, we all know that bullying happens in schools. And it's how you respond to that. And we are a telling school. We do expect our students to be upstanders and not bystanders and come and let us know. We have our Teams pages, which all our students have access to, where they have an anonymous reporting button. So if people feel they can't come forward and say something, then they can respond anonymously, and then we can look into it and deal with it. But we take any allegation really, really seriously, and we work with the students and work through it to ensure that our students do feel safe and happy in school.
We do a lot of work, Mrs. Paskins, too, don't we, around sort of anti-bullying ambassadors and the whole piece of work around sort of preventative. I don't know if you wanted to talk a bit more to the work that's been done this year around that.
Yes, so my assistant head of year seven has been working very closely. She's had a lot of training around anti-bullying, and her ambassadors have been working with her to promote that. So we've been promoting it in tutor time. We've promoted it in assemblies. We've gained student feedback on how they feel, and our students thankfully have come back and reassured us that they do feel safe in school, they do feel happy in school, and they do feel that actually everything that we're putting in place is the right thing for them.
Can I just say as well, we're very lucky, you know, within our student leadership team, we do have a designated role, which is about well-being. And we also had a head of diversity and inclusion. And I think it's, you know, we very much look at preventing those situations occurring, and our students are amazing ambassadors. You know, they get involved in a variety of different activities, and are, you know, that together with our PHSEE program, which is very, very strong and looking at kind of understanding difference and understanding, you know, what's important about inclusion, really does kind of mean that actually students have that really strong awareness about what is right and wrong. You know, but I also have always believed and always said to students that actually school is a safe place to learn, and we look very much on supporting behaviours and so on, and making sure that those behaviours are addressed, but also making sure those behaviours are not repeated and that students are able to feel empowered to be the best version of themselves that they possibly can be. And that runs through right through from year seven right up to year 13.
And it's probably worth adding in actually that when our students join in year seven, in the first 2 days, we give them lessons on friendships, how to make friends, what to do if friendships fall apart. You know, sometimes that does happen. What can you do? What can you do if, you know, you're not feeling that things are going in the way that you want to, and maybe somebody's saying things to you that is making you feel uncomfortable? So not only do we act on, but we do give all our students those tools very, very early on and help them to resolve friendship issues. We act together and meet with students so that they can talk through how they're feeling, so that they can push through and move on and deal with these issues if they come across them themselves.
I think I just saw a question a moment ago from a parent about, does our vertical system sort of mean that there are sometimes issues between students in older and younger year groups? We very, very rarely see that within school. Where issues of bullying arise, they tend to be concentrated within a year group, within a sort of friendship circle usually. That's not to say that it never happens, but we don't see that frequently at all here at Wycombe High. You will be getting a sense from what my colleagues have just described there that we do very much have a culture of inclusivity here. And I notice we have a question about whether or not we have a Christian ethos at the school. We do deliver as part of our curriculum core religious studies, and one of many things that are taught as part of that is sort of a knowledge and understanding of some of the major world religions. That comprises one part of what's taught in that subject. There's much more to it than that, but we don't collectively worship here at Wycombe High School. We have a culture of inclusivity, really, an ethos that is inclusive, and we try to celebrate all of our religions, of which there are many amongst our student and staff populations. And we feel that it's really important to try to gain a better understanding of those different religions and their beliefs and the different aspects that are celebrated as a part of those. So that's a really important part of our culture too, is that we celebrate that diversity.
And that segues a little bit into what do students make in food tech. I can't give you absolutely the recipe list right at this point, but you will always get ingredient lists in advance. And one of those things they do there is they do reflect the diversity of our young people who are coming in and looking at the sort of different cultural traditions through food. So a question about catchment area, so admissions, which is a particular area, as Mr. Raniel said, I look at. So yes, we do have a catchment area. You can find the map for that on the admissions part of our website. There's also a useful little tool that's linked in at the end of the admissions policy, which allows you to put in your postcode and find out if you are within catchment area. So it can be that students are coming in from outside catchment area. That's not as usual, but our catchment area is really quite large. It has two zones, an A and a B. So it's worth looking at the policy and the map. And if you have any queries, do let us know at admissions and we can help you out with any of that.
I think maybe Ms. Dreyer, so we've got a couple of quick fire questions we can round off before we finish up this afternoon.
Indeed. So do girls have to tie their hair up? Nope, they do not have to have their hair tied up, and Mrs. Passin's going to ask if they get hurt, and I think student support is going to be featuring in that answer.
They will. So we have a bespoke student support area with two qualified matrons. So if someone gets hurt, matron will either be called to go and visit your student, your daughter, or if they can make their way down student support, matron will go down, she will assess it, and then they will give you a call and let you know. If they need to be dressed and they can go back to lessons, matron will do that. Or if we feel that a parent needs to collect, then obviously matron would give you a ring. But quite often they will ask your opinion on things because you are the parent at the end of the day. And if your daughter has injured themselves, you need to have a say in what happens.
So a question there about the distance order or how are students ranked. Once students have reached the qualifying threshold, we do not rank on their score. That's not relevant. They have reached the threshold. They have therefore met the appropriate standard for a grammar school. Distance from the school is part of the oversubscription criteria, but there are also other factors as well. That is where you want to have a look at the admissions policy. It does go through those in quite sort of legalistic language. So if we can help with clarifying, do email submissions at and we can help you out with those.
Thank you very much. Thank you to Mr. Drysdale for so ably managing all of those questions there. I think we've pretty much managed to answer all of the questions that you've had for us this afternoon. I really do hope so. And if there is anything else that sort of pops into your mind, please don't hesitate to get in touch with us here. You can find all of the contact details on the website. You can watch this webinar again if you'd like to and replay it with other members of the family. The recording of this afternoon will go up onto our website too. And of course, please dive into those thousands of hours of Wycombe High TV to give yourself a little bit more of a sense of what we get up to here at Wycombe High. And you can follow us on all of the major social media channels. We're on Instagram, on Facebook and on Twitter as well. So do have a look there. And please remember too, that date for your diary on October the 3rd, when we've got our open event, two time slots, a morning slot at 9 a.m. and an afternoon slot at 2 p.m. And we would very much love to invite you into the school. I believe it's the best way for you to see what we get up to is actually coming in during the day with the opportunity to dive in and out of some of our lessons and see what our students experience every day. There's no substitute for it. So we very much hope that you can join us on that open day on the 3rd of October. Thank you ever so much for joining us this afternoon. Thank you to my colleagues, and we will bring it to a close there. Take care. Bye-bye.